Welcome to the Parish Church of St. Luke Online for this July 17th, 2022, the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. As we come before God, we offer prayer. Let us pray. God of the oppressed, we pray for all those who suffer injustice at the hands of cruel and indifferent rulers, especially for the innocent victims of war. Give them strength and patience, and hasten the day when the kingdoms of this world will own the perfect law of love made known to us in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Oh,
Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son has opened for us a new and living way into your presence. Give us pure hearts and constant wills to worship you in spirit and in truth through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Amos. This is what the Lord God showed me, a basket of summer fruit. He said, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a basket of summer fruit. Then the Lord said to me, the end has come upon my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The songs of the temple shall become wailings in that day, says the Lord God. The dead bodies shall be many, cast out in every place. Be silent. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great, and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Shall not the land tremble on this account, and everyone mourn who lives in it, and all of it rise like the Nile, and be tossed about and sink again like the Nile of Egypt? On that day, says the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feasts into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. I will bring sackcloth on all loins and baldness on every head. I will make it like the mourning for an only son and the end of it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, says the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Psalm 52. Why boastest thou thyself, thou tyrant, that thou canst do mischief? Whereas the goodness of God endureth yet daily, thy tongue imagineth wickedness, and with lies thou cuttest like a sharp razor. Thou hast loved unrighteousness more than goodness, and to talk of lies more than righteousness. Thou hast loved to speak all words that they may do hurt, O thou false tongue. Therefore shall God destroy thee forever. He shall take thee and pluck thee out of thy dwelling, and root thee out of thy land of the living. The righteous also shall see this and fear, and shall laugh him to scorn. Lo, this is the man that took not God for his strength, but trusted unto the multitude of his riches, and strengthened himself in his wickedness. As for me, I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. My trust is in the tender mercy of God forever and ever. I will always give thanks unto thee for that thou hast done, and I will hope in thy name, for thy saints like it as well. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. And you, who were once estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he is now reconciled in his fleshly body through death, so as to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith, without shifting from the hope promised by the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am completing what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church. I became its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery that has been hidden throughout the ages and generations but has now been revealed to his saints. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of his mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is he whom we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Luke. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village, where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is a need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth, meditations of all our hearts, be accepted in thy sight, O God, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Dr. Rowan Williams, former Archbishop of Canterbury, in his book, Where God Happens, writes, I strongly believe that the promise that the church will not fail can be relied upon. This is because the church is the community of those whom Jesus calls to receive the Spirit and to share the relation that he has with his Father, his source. Jesus did not stop issuing that invitation, and so the church does not stop existing. That, to me, is the bottom line. Williams goes on to say, everything begins with this vision and hope, to put the neighbor in touch with God in Christ. On the rest of Christian life depends. Failing to win the neighbor is to stand in the way of Christ, to block Christ's urgent will to communicate with all. Paul, in his letter to the Colossians, notes, he is the head of the body, the church. So what do you think? Do you agree with the Apostle Paul and Dr. Williams? Do you think that they are on the right track? I want to suggest that both Paul and the former Archbishop are giving us much to ponder and much to think about. The focus of Paul in his letters is our relationship with Jesus Christ. Christ has to be our focus in all that we do. And Rowan Williams builds on this theme. Williams would suggest that understanding the historic and orthodox faith made contemporary for our time is the best approach. Williams has an unwavering belief that the church, founded on Jesus Christ, is the last best hope for humankind. He believes this in spite of the challenges that the church faces. In our own lives, our relationship to Jesus Christ is to be front and center. It is done not to be some sort of Jesus freaks, but to enter into the spiritual depth we need to be mature Christians. It is needed to keep us together in a world that has sidelined us. We need to be really sure in what we believe in order that we can go out and face the world. By keeping the focus on Jesus Christ, suggests the church, with all its humanness, may very well be the last best hope for humankind. Imagine what the world, our country, might be like without the church. What would we lose? I think we would lose our moral compass. We would lose our anchor. We would lose any connection to living our faith in community. Community, as we understand it, would no longer exist. The world would dissolve into something, but something that would not rest on the traditions of Jesus Christ. Our focus would be only on us and not community. Paul wrote this letter to the Colossians in response to the Gnostics. The Gnostics have, for the most part, devalued Christ and rejected that he is fully human and fully divine. Paul's response was to counter the claims of the Gnostics that the creating God was not the true God, that Jesus was not unique, that Jesus was not fully man, and that the Gnostics refused to see Christ as the center of and the source of salvation. Paul wanted this early church to see the folly of Gnostic thought. Paul does this in this text in three parts. Part one is a magnificent hymn that praises Christ as head of the created order. Key to understanding Christ is his central place in the created order and through his redemptive works. Christ is seen as God's agent of reconciliation in the world. Part two is the impact of Christ on the church. This church has experienced reconciliation. The focus is the congregation. Theologian Fred Craddock notes, our text provides one of the most natural ways for us to establish our identity as a church. Contrasting what we once were with what we are now with Christ as the pivot of change. This form of comparison, once you were but now you are, seems to be one of the standard forms of early Christian teaching and preaching. Key to growing in faith is steadfastness and constant adherence to the gospel. and part three is the impact of Christ on Paul. Paul envisions Christ's own suffering as continuing into the life of the church. Paul envisions the suffering he undergoes on behalf of his church as a continuation of the suffering that Christ endured. The suffering of Christ continues in the suffering experience of his messengers and the members of his body as Craddock notes. It gives us pause to think of Christ as so closely identified with his own that his own suffering continues even in the exalted status as Lord. Christ for Paul has become the center of the apostolic commission. For this reason, Christ forms the center of Paul's apostolic proclamation, his hope that eventually everyone who is in Christ will become mature in Christ. So what does that mean for us in the church? The church originated with Christ. The church is Christ's doing and not ours. The church depends on Christ continually for its source of energy and power. And through the resurrection, it was the beginning of the new humanity, recreation, united with Christ. We have new life. British Congregationalist preacher P.T. Forsyth described the cause for the impotence of the modern church with both devastation and simplicity. P.T. Forsyth writes, "We have churches of the nicest, kindest people who have nothing apostolic or missionary, who never knew the soul's despair or its breathless gratitude. The church has to be bold in what it believes and in proclaiming the faith. If it does not, the risk is we become a poor imitation of a social club. Keeping Christ at the center sends us out into the world. Just think if the world heard our message, what would the world could and be like?" Paul's ministry is part of the final revelation of God's ultimate mysteries. In other words, Paul reminds us when we do not remember who we are or who Christ is, we struggle in our faith and fail to grow in our relationship in Christ. As one writer notes, faith is the electrical lead through which the power of Christ via the Spirit gets wired into our hearts. Far from a personalized me and Jesus perspective, there can be no union with Christ without also sharing commitment with all other things and people Christ redeemed. This text holds out the hope that in Christ it all comes together. It is possible to understand reality through faith in the God from whom all things came, but whom all things have been saved, and in whom the entire universe is now held together in hope. This is not a simple message or even a simple formula, but it is the gospel recognition that reality is not a booming, buzzing confusion, and history is nor, contra Henry Ford, a random string of one thing after another. It is why we consider the church to be the last best hope for humankind. Jesus Christ is the impetus that holds us together. It is why the church is called to be bold in its proclamation, living the hope that Jesus calls us to do. It is why we as a people of faith will endure because of the hope of Jesus Christ, who guides and shapes us on the journey that we are on. Amen. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection.
resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
O divine being, in your presence, we stop the busyness around us. We quiet the busyness within us. Gather us together to pray with the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear us as we pray. O Holy One, on this summer's day, we gather at church or in our homes, perhaps with a friend in the sun. Our intention and our need is to worship, to be in community, and to unite ourselves with you. Hear us, Lord, as we pray, saying, Spirit within us, hear our prayer. Holy and omnipotent One, we sit beneath the shade of a birch tree and absorb the heat of the day and the sun's rays. We are quite amazed by the full bloom of flowers, the deep green of the grass and tiny buds with their secret well hidden. Oh, how blessed are we. We are richer for such beauty. Spirit within us, hear our prayer. Almighty One, July brings many changes to our world. One cardinal item in Canada is a break from school. Families are at the lake or traveling by air or on land. Protect them as they travel, as they play in different settings. Be with the child without parental supervision or the gift of a new place to play. Keep each child safe from danger, wherever they may be. Spirit within us, hear our prayer. God of rain and storm, we pray knowing the devastation of the overland flooding in southern Manitoba. Weather predictions include a hot summer. May this be so and be sufficient to alter conditions that decide how Manitobans live. We offer our prayers for property owners and businesses. As summer brings heat and change of surroundings, it may deliver sufficient heat to burn. We ask for limited forest fire damage, protect our land, our communities, and the firefighters. Spirit within us, hear our prayer. O God, our refuge, we turn to you in a moment of silence. Hear our numbered prayers of thanksgiving, sadness, or worry. Spirit within us, hear our prayer. God, who knows the violence in our world, we pray about the continued insurgence in the greater Middle East. We pray for civilians, especially children, caught in the menace called war. Be present in Afghanistan, Yemen, Iraq, Syria, and Sudan. We pray continually for efforts in Ukraine. Still the minds of the military leaders in so many countries and give them the courage to see an alternate vision. In the African continent, we ask for your continued care in the Diocese of Central Buganda. We give thanks for the reopening of 139 spaces in the orphan school program. We are grateful for rebuilding efforts of the Companion Diocese of Central Buganda and Rupert's Land. Spirit within us, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, one careful plea we offer. Let there be peace in our streets, in our cities, our province, and our land. Spirit within us, hear our prayer. Spirit of healing, we pray for members of our community who are not well in body, mind, or spirit. We ask that your presence surround the elderly and those with chronic disease. We especially pray for friends in hospice care. Be with them in their everyday challenges. May all who suffer illness, addiction, poverty, or abuse be made whole and know your peace and your comfort. In hospitals, homes, and hospice, we salute the caregiver and her ability to provide medical care, often mixed with compassion and humor. We ask that the love and service of the medical provider be guided and strengthened by your healing presence. Spirit within us, hear our prayer. Redeeming sustainer, visit your people and pour out your strength and courage upon us. May we hurry to welcome you, not only in our concern for others, but by serving them generously and faithfully in your name. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, accept our praise and thanksgiving. Help us in all we do to offer ourselves as a true and living sacrifice through Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. You are the source of light and life for all your creation. You have made us in your own image and call us to new life in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, you do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. And in the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ, and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, let us pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We, being many, are one body, for we all share in the one bread.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, as we are strengthened in these holy mysteries, may our lives be a continual offering, holy and acceptable in your sight, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Glory to God.
Whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.